Kako ćemo videti viđenje švedske kulture I rad vaših filmskih umjetnika?
Thank you very much. I'm of course very pleased to be invited to this part of Serbia, to this beautiful part of Serbia, and I'm particularly pleased to be invited to this film festival, which is one of the bigger in the country and in the region. As the festival was founded in 1992 and it has grown ever since, I think that one really has to respect the effort that the organizers have to invest in order for this festival to survive and to develop through many, many very difficult years. Being the ambassador of Sweden, I would therefore like to thank the organizers for inviting us and for the fact that this year's festival of European film has the segment entirely devoted to new Swedish film. I'm of course very pleased to hear that the Swedish film is referred to as very hot at this moment in time. The audience will have the opportunity to see 8 Swedish films that have mainly been produced between 2010 and 2011. The audience will also have the opportunity to meet many Swedes that have been engaged in making them. Some of them will, in one way or the other, participate in juries or in other programs of this festival. I would also like to take this opportunity to greet them and to wish them welcome to Serbia. I think that all countries in Europe are proud of their cinematography, and so is Sweden. The film industry in Sweden has a very active branch. In the beginning of this year, it was announced that 41 new Swedish films would be out on the market in 2012. Some of them have already been in Serbian cinemas, like the Nobel Testament and Easy Cash. Today, later in the afternoon, 2 Swedish films will be shown, Las Palmas and a short film, and a feature film called Avalon. I read that it was meant that this film was supposed to be called After 8, but the chocolate producer of After 8 was not very pleased about it, so the film became to be called Avalon. With these films, the program New Swedish Film will also be open. Avalon had its world premiere at the Toronto Film Festival in September 2011, and then it won the prize as the best debut. That was also the first time that any Swedish film won a prize at the Toronto Film Festival. We hope that many more Swedish films will reach international success as this film has reached, and that it will happen during the coming years. And hopefully, there will be more opportunities to have them shown here in Serbia. Thank you very much.
Hvala gospodinu ambasadoru. Uz napomenu da ćemo još jedan švedski film, Krunski dragovi, gledati večeras u 23 sati na letnjoj pozornici u glavnom takmičarskom programu I toplom vam poručujem. S nama danas je programski direktor Miroslav Mogorović I ukazali smo gospodine Mogorović na švedski film, ukazali smo na neke aspekte glavnog takmičarskog programa. Čini se da festival koji je 50 godina započeo koncepciju festivala evropskog filma upravo u ove godine daje najbolje iz kinematografije starog kontinenta. Slažiš se?
Da, malo da stvarno iskažem lično zadovoljstvo I zadovoljstvo svih nas koji smo krenuli na ovaj tom trenutku pomalo neizvestan put redefinisanja festivala u smeru festivala Evropskog filma I da je taj dugotrajni rad napokon dobio pravi rezultat, a to je da smo referentni festival koji je u mogućnosti da zahvaljujući ličnom trudu našim kvalitetima selektora upoređenih ekipa gospodina Mitrića stvarno predstavi ono što je Evropska filmografija nudi. Neke godine smo srećni, neke godine smo tužni, pošto mi nekajemo filmove koje prikazujemo, ali ono što hoću da kažem je da je odnosno mogućnosti da festivalu prikažemo najsavremenije nastvore i najsvežije filmsko ostvarenje, da je kroz Kanski festival da imamo značajan broj filmova koji čine okosnicu, uglavnom tako da smo programa uz filmove sa Berlinskog festivala i svi ti filmovi su premijer prikazani na Paliću. Ono što je doprinjeno mogućnost je da prikažemo te filmove nije samo želja i izbor selektora koja je Nikitine Kupođa Mitrića, nego i infrastruktura koja je moguća na stranu otvorenog univerziteta i Subotica koji je obezbedio tehničke uslove da ovaj put, po prvi put imamo DCP, Digital Cinema Projection na dva mesta, na lepe pozornici i na terivu i prostoru bioskopa Jadra. I zahvaljujući tome omogućili smo da ono što je stvarno savremeno i prikažemo suprotno, ako bismo bili prinuđeni da filmove prikazujemo shodno formatima, ne bismo se ni izli za našli u ovoj situaciji. Na okosnicu programa nam sada tehnički čine formati kao što je DCP, a mislim da imamo samo 4 filma, uglavnom tako da smo programu koji su 35-ice, u toku je nova revolucija, što je nekad bio prelazak sa nebog na tonski film, sada je prelazak sa 3. trake na digitalne projektore, u smislu aktuelnosti, tako da je ovaj festival stvarno uspeo da uz velike napore dođe do toga da ima i tehničke mogućnosti, da prikaže ili ostvarenja koje su selektovane od strane našeg selekcionog tima.
Dakle, i tehnički idemo u korak sa Evropom i sa trendovima digitalizacije. Paralelni program i negde odmah iza glavnog takmičarskog programa po značaju u manjoj većini jedan drugi program jeste paralelni sudari, koji ste došli do 90 nagrada. I od te nagrade uključuje tročlani žiri međunarodnog karaktera žiri i čine i kritičari. Gospodin Petar Mitrić je selektirao 10 filmova, naravno lista želja je bila siguran sa dugačka, ali ono što smo dobili, šta su negde zajednička obeležja filmova koje ćemo već od popode gledati?
Prvo da kažem da osnovna stvar kod ove selekcije je bilo pronaći nove autore koje tek počinju i bave se filmom u mostu na prostoru istočne Evrope. Možda znamo da prilično teško snimiti film u većini zemalja i budžeti su mnogo manji nego u zapadnoj Evropi, tako računamo da se mi zemlje da je recimo u Balkanu.
Čak 7 filmova je debitantski, tako?
Tako da ovaj godin imamo čak 7 debitantskih filmova i sad se pomislimo samo koliko je mi teško snimiti film, mi teško snimiti prvi film. Mene je iznenadilo to s kakvom hrabrošću oni ulaze u takve poduhvat i neverovatno je što su to izuzetno uspešni autori koji ćemo verovatno slušati mnogo više. I to je što se tiče uopšte prvog odredila za stvaranje ovakvog programa. Sa druge strane, ono što je mene iznenadilo je što žanrov svi su poradili te filmove i mi imamo film iz Litvanije, koji je naučno fantastični film. I ovaj, što je spremni bio slučaj, čak nema nikakve tradicije za litvanske kinematografije. Međutim, eto, ti mladi ljudi su sasvim drugačije otvorenije razmišljaju o ovoj kinematografiji i uspevaju nekakve od svoje ideje. Nadam se da ćete uživati u ovom programu i mislim da filmski kritičare posebno je bitno da pogledaju te filmove, da pogledaju njihove strane, da kažu šta je loše i ovaj, otvoreni točni.
I onda će imati priliku i da porazgovaraju sa gostima, pošto će bukvalno svaki film pod lampom i programom i programom obrazali su da imati gospodin festival, tako će, tako da ćemo biti u prilici da razgovaramo sa rediteljima, odnosno autorima. Izvolite kolege, imali pitanja za selektorski tim i gospodina ambasadora.
Branka Balaban, internet portal Superinfo. Za selektorski tim bih imala pitanje kakve su pozicije sada evropske kinematografije u odnosu na američku, uzimajući u obzir i sveža, tako da kažemo, socio-ekonomsku političku situaciju.
Well, I think the strongest good we have being Europeans is the diversity that Europe has to offer. I mean, even so, it's often seen as one territory. Of course, Europe consists of, you take their soccer, UEFA, whatever thing, out of 53 countries. We have 53 countries in Europe. Okay, America maybe has 53 states. States, but they always do the same films with the same actor, with the same faces and the same ventricles. That's why they are all around the world. But we have this richness to take from. That's why it's so great to run with my dear colleagues, a European selection, because the films are so diverse, having from like In the Fog, having like yesterday's two opening films, Just a Bit and then Barbara. There's so much richness in it, in stories and in history. I love right now that there are some young European directors who go back in the history, but they go back with a very fresh and very human approach to it. So the way, for example, Christian Petzold, probably one of the best, most outstanding German directors, together with Andreas Dehn, who was very often guest here, that Palitsch goes back to tells the East German story, tells a story between East and West Germany. So I'm sure especially the Serbian audience can relate very much to this. We all knew and we all remember how it was before 1890, but he does it in a very interesting approach, because he goes down to a very simple human story. So I think that's like the good about European cinema, that they have this rich history, that they have this diversity, but right now they manage to tell their story one person or two people. So they manage to break this big history down to one or two persons, to very personal conflicts and struggles.
Thank you so much.
And there's also a lot of humor this year, which should not be forgotten, because especially Central and Eastern European cinema is not always boring, dark, black and white. And one example of this is a great Finnish film. We have Iron Sky, about Nazis from the dark side of the moon. But also the Swedish film, as Sweden is so hard, we decided to take Crown Jewels in the competition, which was written today, which is also very entertaining and humorous.
Izvolite, imali još pitanja za naše selektore? Ukoliko ne, ja vam se zahvaljujem i pozivam ovogodišnjeg dobitnika nagrade Aleksandra Livka, gospodina Žana Kvara, da se prijavi za stolom.
$200 million movie will the next day, once it's come out, be on the internet for free. So I think right now we're seeing a big desperation in the way things were done in the 20th century can't be done in the 21st century. I think that one has to make a difference between the big market, which is dominated like gas, like something, a multinational corporation. That's the main American movement today is keeping a market that is basically concentrated around 12 to 25 years old. And it's a sure market, and it's a good business, and it should be allowed. But I think now, what the point I think is essential is we're in this total revolution. And for example, I have a film here that cost 300,000 euros to make called The Sexual Chronicles. My partner and I, Pascal Arnaud, we're trying to have an economic coherence in the production for a certain kind of product that we can sell at a reasonable price all around the world, to be released very short release, but then we'll make their money back eventually. And this is what I think is important, and what I think artists today should realize is you can get some films done with private equity. You can, in time, especially 2-3 years afterwards, even if the film is mediocre, get that money back if you can start controlling the DVD and the VOD. And all of a sudden, of course, we're in this full transformation, but like I said last night, I think the internet is going to be a way of being able to communicate European culture outside of the market. And I think it's being done already, and the markets, I mean, the profession is adapting. Just for an example, why it's so frustrating, in France, for example, a film that should cost €1 million costs €4 million because the industry needs it to be functioning in the same kind of criteria that was functioning in the 20th century. And it just doesn't work anymore because, and that's why we have a subsidized cinema is in France, is it's basically just making films for France, which are going to stay in France and not go outside. And so it becomes a very uncompetitive, not possible for crazy people to come and make movies kind of atmosphere. And that's why it's a little bit dull in Europe right now, because we are trying to save our industries, and cinema is the victim of that.
Ali ovaj festival pokazuje da je evropska kinematografija i dalje vrlo žilava i da će se boriti. Kolege, vi imate prednost kada je gospodin Bajer u pitanju i želim da čujemo vaše pitanje. Izvolite, ima li? Dok ih ne bude, hajmo da se vratimo vašem radu. Pred festival i juče smo mogli da gledamo neke od vaših filmova. Kojim kriterijima vi birate uloge? I kako odlučujete u ovome želim da učestvujem i ovo želim da imam, a ovo ne?
As an actor and a director? Just as an actor. You know, it changes, you know, when you're young, when you've got the young leads, you have a lot of films thrown at you. All of a sudden, you're very picky. Especially when you're young. As you get older, you realize that one thing that I wanted to try to do after The Big Blue, which was a big success worldwide, I could have gone to America, I stayed in Europe, now there's many different reasons. I need to have a challenge. I come from a middle class American background. I have a house in California. I can take a risk. And so after The Big Blue, I decided that I was a very green actor. I didn't know much about the profession, that I needed to take chances. So I just said I would do anything that takes my fancy. Small roles, medium roles, large roles. I was looking, and what I look for most when I'm working in a film is a real judgment of character. And choosing Lars von Trier, one of the most strangest people I've ever met, was why I wanted to work with him, because I found that he was coming from another planet, a little bit like me, and trying to come to Earth and talk about being human. I really look at the director and who he is, and that to me is a big thing. If not, it has to be a very good script. And what's nice now about 50 years old, I'm 50 years old, is that after having taken those risks, I really am finding my time in front of the camera and a true liberty, a true freedom of doing what I want to do. And I think it's because I'm not having to defend a $20 million salary. And I'm really excited about my work now. Things I was dreaming about watching my older colleagues when I was a young man, I'm starting to find a little bit of those fruits, and it's very exciting to be able to participate in that and be able to do it in a little independent Tunisian movie, as well as doing it in a really big American commercial film. I'm so difficult, I'll do anything good.
А у случаю сирського книгами фільма «Практичний водич», який збивав це певним плаканням, Штайн біла вона критична та шкода в кіда вжалі для участь в одному фільму. Сценарію?
Yeah, well, the thing is with Boyd, I got the script through the internet, and I'm sensitive to a lot of the films that we've done. I know a little bit about Yugoslav and Serbian cinema, and I found that the script had a certain subversive, and I was intrigued by the musical sequences. And so I found that it wasn't something that was in the classical Serbian kind of cinema. And I last year, a few years ago, did a Tunisian independent, I did an Italian independent film, I did an American independent film, did a Serbian independent film, and it's just a joy to be able to go another direction. It was true entertainment to watch the Serbs and the Germans working together. That, doing the film for that was everything. And I was impressed by the humor of Boyd, and that's really what I wanted to pursue.
Колеги, изволите, има ли питання? Нема да мати вече ради кой други кой, само с това
Kada je reditinski posao u pitanju, verovatno imate slične kriterijume, ali imam utisak da idete malo dalje. Vaši filmovi apsolutno su neobični.
It's because with the new technology available, why not explore new territories? My criteria as a director is I co-direct and I co-produce with Pascal Arnaud, and our budgets have been gradually getting lower and lower and lower, and sometimes you just have to shoot, and it's a risk, and you take what you can get in the time given, and you try and advance. I mean, making a film is chaos, and making a film in 3 weeks with little money and is a real kind of challenge. It's like taking a boat out into sea and getting back into port. It's a crazy thing. It's a wonderful adventure. It's the same kind of adventure I see when I'm doing an actor. Being an actor, I don't have a responsibility, so I have a great time every time I come back from directing and going to act, because I know exactly what's going on upstairs. So I really, for me, to make a movie is a human adventure where you put a lot of confidence and trust in a lot of people. Sometimes you don't get it back. Sometimes a film can sink because of the ego of an actor or producer or director. It's very fragile. And so I think the real talent, and this is what Lars von Trier does very well, with a couple other directors that I work with, is they establish a humanity behind the camera to try and pursue it in front of it. And so there's a real humble quality about shooting that kind of thing, and it's the total opposite of what you would find in Hollywood, because in Hollywood it's about making money, and you don't try and be humble. It's not, making money is not a humble thing. but it's just as bad. I'm not saying Hollywood is bad. It's a result of the Industrial Revolution, and right now it's at its peak, and maybe it's not going to be as strong
anymore. I can in English, ali zašto uvek birate taj rizik? To je meni interesantno. To je nešto što smo videli kod vas u filmu Veliko plavenilo. Vi ste izgleda takav čovjek. To je karakter koji je možda anticipirao vaš put. tako da berete rizik kada nešto radite. Ne skirate kao redite, ne skirate kao klub, kažete sami da film može i da pokrije, može i da ispliva na prvo mesto.
I came from the 70s in California. I was influenced by, I got a chance, because I come from a middle class background, a beautiful house in California, I got the chance to take this. And if ever anything fucked up, I just had to go back to California. So, you know, I really, the chances for me, I maybe two cultures gave me the chance to live the empire, but also to come to Europe and also because I'm half French and really have a true curiosity about culture in France and in Serbia and Germany. I really have a true curiosity in the literature and the drama. And if there's not a risk, there's not it's not worth doing. It's just not worth doing. I mean, you can maybe one day I'll go out to pasture, I'll go to Hollywood and make films and not have to worry about my retirement. But right now, at 50, I saw my retirement in France and it's scary. So that's the risk I'm paying for it. Now I realize that I'm not in a I've just been influenced about keeping my life in a light mode that I can take these risks. I don't have a family, I don't have a wife, so I'm not taking anybody along on this ego trip, because it's a huge ego trip. It's a huge ego trip. And I'm trying to live it through the influence of Henry Miller, Jack Kerouac, the same kind of thrill of celebrating life instead of celebrating yourself. It's hard to do because I really love me.
Hvala gospodinu Žanu Stragu. Siguran sam da će pristati na mini individualne intervjue, tako da budu slobodni, a izvolite, ima pitanje.
Eto da, pitanje interesuje me vezano za sinetni film premijeru iz Rubišta djela seksualnosti. Francuske porodice. E sada, u tom filmu Žan Mazmar je uspeo da prenese jednu jako lepu poruku. U radu je to, meni se čini na neki način zelo budžet filmom i mislim da će to biti komercijalni uspeh. E sad, pitanje je, govore o tome da nije lepo zarađivati tom potumanje. Čisto, kakve su reakcije publike bile u drugim zemljama gde je bilo?
Sexual Chronicles is a film about, we're challenging porno. Not challenging, we're completely for porno. We're just in a world today where sexual representation is dominated 95% by the pornographic industry. And our kids, in complete contrast to our education, have access to images through the internet that their sexual education has a real chance of being formatted through that pornographic look, okay? Which is not bad. It's over years, it's not the same as since the 70s. There's a hyper-masculinity that's evident, that's becoming ridiculous. There's a degradation of the woman that's being more and more abusive. And so all of a sudden, Pascal Arnold and myself, we wanted to do an exercise to challenge how sexual representation is shown in our time with the internet. And we we wanted to show reality. We wanted to show, hopefully, to younger audiences that sexuality is part of life, that it's a joy, that it's a pleasure, and that we have nothing against how porno is a good thing. It's a good thing. But how can we watch people making love Since we can watch people getting killed and making love on the internet all day long, why can't we watch two characters, two actors, pursue their characters with the real act of making love? Because for 8 years, we've been served love as two people having this wonderful elated time imitating the act. And you're realizing you're seeing this for the millionth time and you don't feel anything, but this is love. And so we just wanted to take it a little step further and ask ourselves, what can we see in the cinema since we are in the 21st century and we have access and we're saturated with so many images? Why can't they go for an intimacy? And the shocking thing about Sexual Chronicles is that it's not shocking. It resembles real life. And all of a sudden you're celebrating the joy of sex. In the same spirit, I think, is what the early 70s of Sweden, they really use that. And it's in that same spirit. And what's funny is, in France, for example, most of the distributors in our country are over 50-year-old alcoholics and men. And for them, sexuality is still in a very kind of 20th century place, and we only released the film at 17 cinemas in all of France, but we lasted 2 weeks, which is with 20 films coming out a week in France, quite good. But we're depending on the success, because a lot of people were interested in the film, of being able to recoup on the DVDs and the VODs. That's our hope, and that's our plan. And the other countries I'm going to go show, I just showed the film in Moscow, in Moscow. And to watch the Russians, the young Russians, completely laugh, and it's a joyous film, celebrate the same sexuality, was just so proud. Now, next month, I'm going to Los Angeles, and I'm showing it at the American Cinematheque. So we'll see how the Americans are going
to take it. Pozdrav gospodina Zorana Simjanovića, ovogodišnjeg domaćeg dobitnika nagrade Aleksandra Vihira, da se pridruži. Moram da budem iskren da se čuo da ste vi domaći dobitnik, ja zmišljam se kako ćemo ovu preskonferenciju voditi, mislim, naš razgovor će teći između ostalog sa muzikom iz vašeg filmova, da ću ostaviti za njih najbolji put. Sili smo čuli samo deo širok spektra onoga što ste nam vi podarili. Gledao sam Sili Želenke posljednice i ste na trenutku cukrali koji je gospodina Zelenovića i slušali kako neki drugi muzičari, konkretno su gotički, dugački orkestar, izvodi vašu muziku. I šta u tom trenutku misli kompozitor? Je li ovaj ton otišao gore? Da li je ovo malo drugačije? Šta radi ovaj duha? Šta biste mislili?
Pa dobro, ima i to, kad je to dobro sviramo i tijelo. Kad ti drugi uzme da svira svoju muziku, on nešto napravi svoje, onda je to interesantno. Recimo, najviše me šokirao izraelski prevod Dalje Beova, koji je prevod neke moje pesme, jedan potpuno drugi način. I ja sam bio potpuno ovako, u Rimu to radili nešto, ja sam bio odrušen, kako je to zvučalo, moja muzika zvuči drugačije. Ali dobro, tako da, uvek neko kad uzme da pravi neku svoju muziku, pomeri kao i mi, što neku tuđu kompozeciju koju smo okrenuli. Ali je to i lepo to, lepo kad čuješ svoju kompoziciju.
Siguran sam da gledate dosta filmova aktualne produkcije i kako u ovom trenutku ocenjujete gde je zapravo muzika u savremenoj evropskoj industriji, pošto smo konkretno na festivalu evropskog filma?
Uopšte mislim da imamo veliki problem sa filmom. To ne zbog muzike i muzičara, nego iz nekog prava. Prvo što regulacija autorskih prava, kako producenti se odnose prema autorima. Autori ne žele da prave krenjane muzike, jer producenti žele da imaju sva njihova autorska prava. I on odgovorno prije što to mora da mora da mora i uzme svoje pare i završi priču. Nema više lajne teme, nema više takvih muzika koje su bili super hiper i filmske muzike. Sad se prave neke ugovore, popore muzike i to tako prođe, uzme se pare. Mora da se nešto radi bilo to drugo, internet, ta piraterija muzička, to je strašno, mislim, to je potpuna degradacija. je i film i filmski muzika. Eto tako, danas napraviš film, sutra je na internetu i svi gledaju taj film i niko ništa ne plaća. Ne treba nama da plaća, nego nema film, nema para. To država mora, države, Evropa i ceo mora da nešto reći. Ili će kroz neke druge vidove da financira proizvodnju filma i muzike, pa će onda ta muzika da se daje gledati, ovako komunistički, svi ne gledaju, ali neko mora da plaća. To je suština u tome. Ne sve, neko mora da plaća. Ne sam samo imao ko je taj komunistički.
Dramskih umjetnosti predavali ste mi primjenu muziku i jedno od pitanja na ispitu je bilo kada kompozitor počinje rad u filmu. Nisam se baš najbolje pokazao u tom odgovoru, niste mi dali 10, pa sada vam radim pitanje. Ja vama kada kompozitor treba da počne rad u filmu?
Pa, ja sa mojim prijateljima počeo već u fazi njihovog razmišljanja o novom filmu. Znači, recimo, sredstvo se Goran Marković, on može biti da razmišlja možda bih sinio jedan film o Peri Petrovića koji će sad da je i već tu počuti pričamo i o muzici. Jer tu muzika je organski deo filma. Ona mora da bude uvučena u film, ona mora da bude veze između reditelja i kompozitora. Ako to nije, ako je to separatno, razgojeno, onda je to zaletena muzika na film. Ali ako od početka kompozitor i reditelj počnu da pričaju o toj muzici, o tome kako ta muzika, šta treba da uradi muziku u filmu, da bi film bio to što jeste, onda to funkcioniš, onda je to organska muzika koja zove svega toga. Goran jednom rekao, ja se to potpuno slažem da kompozitor, mora da se poništi kao kompozitor, da bi napravio muziku za film. Ali ne u onom potpuno smislu poništenja, nego sad ja treba da napravim neku fenomenalnu muziku i koja bi upropastila film. Naprotiv, treba da napravim muziku koja odgovara filmu, a da bude i odgovarano. I ja sam se to trudio i da sam uspeo.
To sam vidjela i sinoć. Kolege, izvolite, imali pitanje za gospodina Simjanovića. Kolegice, izvolite.
Branka Blagon, internet portal Superinfo. U festivalskom biltenu čitamo da će vaše drugo literarno delo biti Kako sam postao i prestao da budem filmski kompozitor. Da li to znači da ne verujete u mogućnost da muzika ponekad nadživi film za koji je pravljena i da li postoji mogućnost, u stvari da li postoji ideja neke muzike za koju vam još niko nije ponudio film?
Ja nikad ne radim muziku napred. Ja uvek muziku imam nekoliko muzika koje su mi se dopale kad sam to onako slučajno su mi ispole i stoje i nikad ih nisam upremio. Jer jednostavno nisam pronašao film za koju bi ta muzika mogla da bude. Samo kad gledam film, iz tog filma izlazi ta ideja za moju muziku i onda je ona organska veza za taj film i to funkcioniš. Što se tiče ovog, te moje knjige, to je kao i sa rock and roll. Ja nikad nisam prestao da budem rocker. Mislim, to jednom se špricaš i postaneš rocker i ostaneš do kraja rocker u staračkom domu. Tako isto je sa filmom. Jednostavno, ja sigurno nikad neću prestati da budem filmski kompozitor, ali je situacija toliko strašna od sve ovo što sam govorio malo, da jednostavno više nema svrhe da se čovjek bavi filmskom muzikom, jer ili treba da žvrljaš nešto i trljaš i da praviš neke gluposti, ili bolje da ne radiš nešto.
Ali sad govorimo o onoj drugoj varijanti, znači na jako mnogo primjera kada je muzika na neki način nadživela film, odnosno čak je film na neki način i promovisao.
Pa, film i muzika su u stvari vrlo, oni se vezuju zajedno. Stoji, kad sam ja počinio se bavim filmom, onda je postojan princip da filmska muzika treba da krene 15 dana ranije pre premijere filmu, da bi upoznala i uvela ljude u film. Ti slušaš, ali ne mnogo, 15 dana maksimalno. Recimo, bio je primjer Šaft. Mi smo Šaft slušali, recimo, 3-4 godine, 5 godina ranije i onda je film došao u Beograd i mi gledamo film. Pa bolje je muzika nego film. Mi smo toliko tu muziku već sažvakali, nije znamo, fantastično, sve i se slušaš muziku, ali gledaš neke snike. Znači, ne sve u toj meri muzika da ide u napred pre filmu. Nego mora da man pozna, da zaintrigira gledalca i kad gleda film, on ono prepozna nešto, ali gleda novi film sa novom muzikom. Znači, tu je ta neka organska veza.
A zašto to nije zaživjelo ovdje kod nas? To se nije desilo. Ko je tu kriv? Film je ti, muzičari, kompozitori, situacija?
Ja mislim da je sistem kriv. Nekad je to funkcionisalo, ja sam čak i insistirao da izdavim ploču za film. Od prvog svog filma, specijalno ispitanje, dve, četiri stvari, pa mir iz poljskog cveća, pa nacionalna klasa, pa sve pošljiva, pa reda, sve sam pokušavao i to smo uvijek izdavali tako u trenutku. Međutim, to su bili koji račun da idu. Izdavio bih tamo reda radi, da bih učinio. Uvijek, što se jedno da učinio. Svi su meni činili i ja sam onda rekao, ma neću više. Tako da nemoj da mi čini priča. Tako da jednostavno, taj sistem ne funkcioniše. Na zapadu je glavni što da ovi prodaju ove CD. Ovdje uzme Amerikanac sva prava da bi prodavao CD i uzimo pare. A ovdje ti čini. Mislim da to funkcioniše normalno i da jedno s drugim, jedno drugo gura. Imam ja sliku, recimo, Goran i ja potpisujemo, Goran Marković, ja potpisujemo ploču nacionalna klasa. Lepi smo plati i ta ploča još živi.
Ima li još pitanja za gospodina Simjanovića? Ukoliko ne, ja vam se zahvaljujem i želimo ponovno da svi imamo hvala. Sa nama je još jedan dobitnik nagrade, ali Anja Njavu Spirit Award. Reč je o reditelju Jelenu Utkilenu koji je danas sa nama i pridružit ćemo se za konferencijskim stolom.
Thank you. This film made in a kind of different way. I wanted to experiment with storytelling. So this film started with nothing. And I didn't know what it would be about. And it starts, it's a sort of working method I sort of developed, this kind of study where I have conversations with people or actors about them. So from these conversations, I start getting ideas for scenes, and then I start writing the scripts, and then I'll put together the script for 5 to 10 pages, and I'll go and shoot them, and then I'll start writing the next bit. So it goes on like that for a while, for 8 shoots that particular film. So they, I suppose, the people or the characters of the actors, they play a sort of fictionalized version of themselves.
Film vede l'iniziativa delle discipline che sono ricerche su quale si chiede da veliko interasio che io voglio ma mari duchi in Europa, se quale si nasce il nostro lo spoglio di Woodkillenu e scelimo da a što je film in un attimo in questo festival. Govorit ćemo o filmu samo Veta, danas su se nama Katalin Toldi i Genji Lendva i glumice Silma, one će nam se pridružiti. Da vas podsjetim, film je na ovogodišnjem Belgijskom filmskom festivalu nagrađen 7 metodom što je druga najznačajnija nagrada u festivalu. Glumice filma su danas s nama, Bernardo Peroški, a za prevod koristit ćemo Kanal 2 za prevođenje sa mađarskog na srpski okrug. Gledali smo sinoć film i sve vreme dok sam gledao film smišljao sam kako apsolutno verujem u vašoj glumi na planu. Pa zato moram da vas pitam kako ste baš vi izabrani da idete u ovom filmu? Je bilo neke audicije, odnosno castinga gde ste svi predstavili reditelju, onda je on koji je odabrao baš vas dve za te dve filmu značenje i zahvalim.
Persze, castingozunk az új. És sokat kellett eljárni testre. Ugye mindig másra kellett próbálni. Voltak törgerek is volt. Nem csak a két gyeres, aki most volt lenne, a mentőben is voltak. És akkor ezzel a kutyán vállalatok, aki mindig esett.
Genji, čime ste se vi vodili te audicije? Ste želeli da prikažete sebe i ponudite ono što imate kao dar u sebi? Da li je film se nešto promenilo posle filma? Ili pa govor je vrlo značajno i potresno i opominjujuće na bolje?
And he's one of the most promising German directors. actually we have a new generation of German cinema now. It's called the Berlin School, and he's one of the main directors of this Berlin School. And I think in the future we can expect a lot of some very great films.
Какво е делата ситуация на нашето кинематографико? И кои си произведи филмова годишния и колико они не елази на отзи по публика в Русал?
I think in Germany we are around 150-170 feature films produced every year. Not every film gets to the theaters. I think in our theaters the releases are around 90-100 German films per year. I have to admit, altogether we have like 500 films to be released in Germany, so it's kind of 20% of all the releases. But the box office is not bad, since we don't have any quota. The box office of German films is around 25%, which is quite good, but also speaks from the quality of German films.
Може ли си говорите на какъв тренд, какъв да речу темата, кой е интересен от инженерите?
Most of the films, they have kind of contemporary subjects. They are dealing with our life today and dealing with the problems today. It's also connected because this kind of subjects are doing better in the theaters than maybe old historical subjects. In the last year, and not just after the life of Marcus, one of the big subjects is the RD80s, the time of the war came down, and that's the first time of really unification. And so I would say the end of the 20th century, so the recent German history is becoming very popular. Second World War is not so popular.
Hvala veliko, danas je sa nama i Žuzi Banguti, predstavnica kompanije Metro, koja će nas pridružiti. Welcome. Match Factory je kompanija koja je vrlo posvećena evropskoj kinematografiji. Što se tiče njihove akte na produkciju poslije godinu dana, gledat ćemo tri filma na festivalu, pa jednom ovdje predstavimo koji je Nikitin, Match Factory, i tako će se kao ljubom zastupen sa takvim filmom.
Exactly, it's presented with three films this year, and as in the last couple of the editions, we always had amazing talents from this company. Just to remind you, Waltz with Bashir, which was back then to be expected at the main award in Cannes, but knowing that nothing, we were the first festival to screen it after Cannes in the competition, and we were the first festival in the world to give it the main award. And for me back then, it was really great to give recognition to Ali Forman, an outstanding also, same year we had Andreas Dresden here with Cloud Nine, which got that year Best Director. And as you all remember, last year, Stop on Track, as well as by Andreas Dresden, was here, and he got Best Movie, and he was here accepting it with his producer, Peter Rommel, who is also a dear supporter of Palage. So having those films in our festival, of course, they all started either Cannes or Berlin or Venice. And remembering what Jean-Marc Barr said earlier, how difficult it is nowadays to realize films, we understand together with Misha especially that words is a really very important job, and we, in a way, are really thankful that there's a company which has a strong profile. So 2 months ago in Cannes, for the first time, we gave our so-called bravest world sales award, and it was received by Michael Weber, who is the CEO of Match Factory. His company is running now for 7 years. Before that, he was running the international was the first time here at the jury in 2003, and it was Nürburgring in Africa becoming a language mine was celebrating that as Babane. So for us it was a clear choice to give this first award to the match record for the outstanding lineup, as we said, to have meaning the portfolio of films. So having Juji here, I just want to use the opportunity to ask her, how does it happen and how do you pick, what's your strategy? So I say, you know, I curate in a way my competition, yes, I try to pick off the best films I see, but how do you, especially as you do a position for mine, how do you pick films, how do you keep up the color? Because it's all about great taste. So when
first of all, the most important that I've been watching more than 1,000 films in a year, so I know what is going on and which one is important and which director is important. But that is not the case.
Hvala i nadamo se da ćemo vašu pjesmu